Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to change the narrative around marriage and family to create a cultural climate favorable to lifelong married love. We also seek to promote recovery and healing from the wounds of the sexual revolution and share our stories with the next generation. I encourage you to visit our website, where you can sign up for our free e-newsletter and receive more information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. We're live at Mass Resistance's Teens4Truth conference at the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary in Fort Worth, Texas. This year, Dr. J is speaking on the gender ideology, especially as it relates to transgenderism.
I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse. I'm founder and president of the Ruth Institute, and my helpers are going to pass out two brochures to everybody. The first is called Do You Know a Survivor of the Sexual Revolution? Nick and Dave are going to be passing those out. And then there's a second one called Counting the Casualties of the Sexual Revolution. What I'd like to do is invite all of you to join with the Ruth Institute. The mission of the Ruth Institute is to create a mass social movement to put a stop to family breakdown. That's our overall objective. And many of you are already on the Ruth Institute's electronic newsletter list. And so if you would like to join that list, that's what the clipboard is that's going around right now. So with all that in mind, I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, and I have been asked to talk with you about propaganda and the transgender and homosexuality movement. Now, this brochure that I'm passing out, we've got Do You Know a Survivor of the Sexual Revolution? And then also back there, Jeff, is the one called Counting the Casualties of the Sexual Revolution. If you wouldn't mind passing those around, that would be great. I'm going to talk a little bit about these brochures once you get them in your hands. But in the meantime, I want to just mention to you that out at the Ruth Institute table, which is right outside the door, we have several other pamphlets that may be of interest to you. We have pamphlets on children and same-sex parenting, children in divorce, and also children in donor conception and assisted reproduction. All of these issues are important to us because we think it's important that children have a relationship with their own parents. And when you open it up, what you'll see is some of the things that people have already talked about. You'll see the hazards and the risks that people, that children endure if their parents are members of a same-sex couple or if their parents are divorced, okay? And so those, we are discounting the prices of those. Everyone is welcome to have one of every pamphlet we have out there, okay? So you can have, just take one of every one. If you want more of them, if you want to put them in your clinic, if you want to buy bulk orders, all of that's on sale out there. And so you can have, you know, you can buy 100 or something like that if you want to take it home with you. So to just go back briefly to Do You Know a Survivor of the Sexual Revolution? Here is the connection that I want to make for you all. Open this pamphlet up and you'll look down this row here, the first, very first column, and you will see, is this you? And the very top, the very first victim of the sexual revolution is the child of divorce. And you look down further and you see the children of single parents. And then you see the reluctantly divorced. Now, when I say the term reluctantly divorced, do you know what I mean when I say that? A person who wanted to stay married, but their spouse ended the marriage. And because of the laws in this country, the government takes sides with the person who wants the marriage the least. That's the law in every state in the United States. That's what so-called no-fault divorce means, okay? So as soon as I say that term, reluctantly divorced, I bet everybody in this room knows somebody who's had that experience, right? But you never heard that term before because we made it up. We invented that term to call attention to this group of people. And you look down further, you'll see familiar people like the post-abortive woman, the pornography addict. Keep going down, you'll see the refugee from the gay lifestyle and the refugee from the hookup culture, and all the way down to people who have health problems due to their abortions, their contraception, or their hookups, all right? Now, the reason I'm pointing this out to you, we've been using this brochure since 2014 in various environments, and the reason it's significant for all of you is that we view the issues of same-sex attraction and homosexuality as just being one more category of victims and survivors of the sexual revolution. It's one giant ideology that is generating all of this nonsense, all right? And so if you're interested in knowing more about that, I have way more material than I can cover today, okay? So I'm not going to talk fast, even though I'm really capable of talking fast, because you won't like that as much. So this presentation that I have here has a lot of references on it. If you will sign up for the newsletter, I will send you a PDF copy of this presentation, which will have on it all of the references to the studies and everything like that that I'm going to be studying. And that way I won't have to zip through it too fast. I'll be able to kind of glance over a few things, but you'll still have access to the information. The other pamphlet I want to call attention to is this one called Counting the Casualties of the Sexual Revolution. Did people get this one as well? Did this one come around? Okay. Now, you'll notice there the iconic Marxist fist crushing the household, okay, smashing the family and the baby falling out of the bottom, okay? Now, if you open it up, what you'll see is our best guess about how many people have been harmed by the different categories of the sexual revolution. And you'll see that many of them, we literally have no idea at all. We have no idea at all how many donor-conceived persons there actually are, for instance. We have no idea at all how many reluctantly divorced people there are. Why don't we know? Because nobody cares to ask the question. Because even asking the question calls the whole ideology into question. And that, of course, we must never do. Because the ideology is the thing. Now, you have to understand that when you're dealing with a revolution, for the true revolutionary, the issue is never the issue. The issue is always the revolution. So it may seem like the issue is transgenderism or bathrooms or whether gays can adopt children or divorce or any of the number of things. But really, the issue is the revolution, and keeping that going, keeping the fantasy ideology going, that it's somehow possible to create this brave new world that they want to bring into being. And I'll say more about that in detail as I go along. So I'll just tell you now, this presentation is going to be archived at the Ruth Institute podcast series. And I also have additional podcasts that go into the contraceptive ideology, the divorce ideology, and the gender ideology in much more detail than I'm going to be able to go into here, along with the PowerPoints are going to be on there too. So you can go into this in as much detail as you want to. Today, I just want to give you an overview of why this issue of the sexual revolution is so important to you guys in the works that you are trying to do, and how it connects with all the other issues that people are having to deal with. So let's move along then. So what is the gender ideology? How do I define the gender ideology? Back in the day, the gender ideology used to be that men and women are identical, except women are better. That's the way I used to describe it back in the day of the feminism. Men and women are the same, except women are better. That's the kind of feminism that I grew up with. But that thing has morphed over time, which I'll explain to you. So therefore, if men and women are really identical, wiping out all observed differences between men and women is a social imperative. All right, and that's how feminism got its start. If those of you who are old enough to remember, this is what was being done. This is being advocated. Any differences you see between men and women are socially constructed and therefore unjust and therefore should be reconstructed by society. So keep that image in mind. Men and women are really the same secretly. You didn't know that, but really men and women are the same. And any differences you observe are all socially constructed and have to be wiped out. Now, examples of this gender ideology in action, all right, is that we have required equality in sports programs. That was the point of Title IX of the Civil Rights Act. They have adapted or changed or basically dropped physical fitness requirements for things like law enforcement officers and the military in order to have women enter those professions. And look at this poor woman, you know, trying to do one pull-up where the guys are doing them with one hand or whatever. So the ideology is that men and women are different, and so we have to do something, or men and women are the same, and so we have to do something to overcome the fact that they aren't the same. And so changing the requirements, the physical fitness requirements, is part of it. Many other examples, we could go on all day, but here's another example. Single-sex education programs are considered unlawful sex stereotyping, and the government subsidizes getting women into the so-called STEM subjects, such as, what does that mean, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Those subjects are the only subjects in which men are still overrepresented. In every other field, every other academic discipline, there are more women than there are men, and that's true in law, medicine, all the humanities, and so on. STEM subjects are the only ones where men retain an advantage. But of course, that's not good enough. We gotta do something to get more girls into those subjects, and so we have this website with all these cute little butterflies and curlicues on it to encourage girls to become engineers. Now, let's ask the obvious question. Are men and women really different? Now, this is an example of a slide that I'm gonna kind of zip through, but you'll have it in the end. You'll have the slide and the references when when I email to you. So if you look at before birth, more boys are conceived in utero than there are girls, about 120 to 100. And the reason is that boys are more vulnerable to virtually every obstetric catastrophe you could think of. Okay, there are more stillbirths, more miscarriages, perinatal brain damage, cerebral palsy, premature birth, the list goes on. Everything bad that can happen in utero is more likely to happen to the boy than to the girl. I suppose this is socially constructed, right? Okay. At birth, the natural sex ratio is 105 boys to 100 girls, and that's because the little boys have other risks after they're born of bad things that are more likely to happen to them. These are examples of male privilege. If you've been anywhere near a college campus, you know that all men have male privilege, and of course all boys are expected to make atonement for this male privilege. But on the list of male privilege includes things like being on the autism spectrum, Tourette syndrome, reading delays, hyperactivity, being disruptive in school, and so on. Leading one scholar to describe boys as being developmentally delayed at birth compared to girls. And that scholar goes on to say, therefore, the boys are in need, particular need, of a competent and compassionate caregiver to help them interface with the world. Okay, in other words, the little boys need their mommies. And we again see that little boys are more vulnerable to stressors in the environment. And there have been studies on all kinds of different things, you know, when they're looking at whether children are really resilient or not, and they look at these various indicators, it's very common to find that whatever the thing is they're studying, the boys are more likely to have a problem than the girls are. So whether it's having a mom that's too young, or having a mom that's depressed, a mother-only home, or too much daycare, it's the little boys who are flipping out in daycare, okay? And so I would suggest to you, it is simply implausible to believe that this is all social construct, right? I mean, there's something different between men and women. So here's some references for the previous slides, and you'll have those when you go home. Now, so sometimes people will ask me, Dr. Morse, where did all this gender ideology come from? Where did the transgender thing come from? It seems like it just came out of nowhere. You know, the minute that gay marriage was enacted, all of a sudden we've got transgenderism coming down the pike. And I want to say that they have been in the process of degendering everybody for a long time. So when I was a little girl, it was perfectly okay for me to say that I wanted to be a mommy when I grew up. But by the time I got into college, it was not okay for me to say that anymore. I had to say, well, I want to be a doctor or a lawyer, and of course I can be a mommy on the side, you know. So that is a way of degendering people, of saying that the thing that is most intrinsically female is not really important to us, and that we must dismiss it as being unimportant. So there are many examples. I put them on up here, and ways in which I'm particularly sensitive to it as a woman. These are things that I've observed in my lifetime, that we have to apologize for being mommies, we have to put it off indefinitely, and so on. But also as a mom, I have to say that I think it's cruel, really cruel, that we expect little boys to sit still in school. in the same way as we expect little girls to sit still in schools. The boys need their outdoor activity, and they need it more than girls do, and they need it in a different way. And if I keep talking about this, I'm going to cry, so I'm just going to go on. Okay, so where does all this stuff come from? I want to suggest to you that the people who've invented these ideologies are all from what we might call the managerial class. That is, people who sit behind desks, people who are college educated, and who and who live in kind of the abstraction. Okay, but if you do that kind of job, if you're a college professor, if you're an attorney, if you're a banker or something like that, you could almost believe that men and women were the same. Because in all of the jobs that are going on around you, everything that's going on around you in your life, yeah, the girls are doing them the same as the boys are doing them. But as soon as you step out of the office and go out to be a farmer, or a high-rise construction worker, or a utility pole lineman, or a lumberjack, all of a sudden, it's not so clear that boys and girls are the same. And of course, members of the managerial class never venture out of their offices, as a rule, right? And so they're trapped in this ideology, and you can see on my slide here that men dominate the death professions. That is, 92% of the deaths that take place on the job take place to men. Okay, so there's something going on here. And of course, we have this iconic photograph of the men sitting on the high-rise building during the Depression, eating their lunches on that girder and seemingly without a care in the world. And, I realize not all guys could do that or would want to do that. But on the other hand, I don't think too many girls would want to be up there either. But anyway, the managerial class is never up there. That's the point. The people who are making all of these rules and inventing this concoction of an ideology, they're never out there doing this type of thing. So the gender ideology recently has morphed. It has morphed from being the what I described in the first place, which is that men and women are identical except women are better. It's morphed into the transgenderism we know today. So it began with father-daughter dances being banned. Okay, do you know that in some localities, father-daughter dances are considered inappropriate, unlawful sex stereotyping? Okay, I mean, it's sad, but true, all right? But now, we are requiring gender-neutral bathrooms. We're requiring it. So there's some, before we were saying there's no difference between men and women, now we're saying that a boy can use a girl's bathroom. How does this even work? How does this work? So let me point out a couple of contradictions to this. At first, we were going to wipe out all the differences between men and women, except those that the individual specifically chooses to bear. That's where we are now. It started out, we're going to ban all differences between men and women. Now, we're allowing people to decide for themselves what gender they are. So we have the phenomenon of Bruce Jenner. Other speakers have pointed this out, and I'll just point it out again. Look at this photograph. Notice the very stereotypical view of femininity. Trust me, I don't dress like that. I've been a woman my whole life, and I don't dress like that. I don't know any girl that I hang around with that dresses like that, okay? This is some man's view of what it means to be a woman, and frankly, I find it offensive. Now, Bruce Jenner makes this ridiculous comment. He says, the hardest part about being a woman is figuring out what to wear. So my caption for this is, clueless Bruce. Okay, I mean, really? That's the hardest part about it, you know? So we've got contradictory visions going on here. As I mentioned, Title IX in the world of sports used to mean that we have to have identical numbers of women's sports and men's sports. We have to have identical numbers of boys participating as girls participating. That vision of Title IX was the pretext for going around to colleges and high schools and shutting down men's wrestling programs. Do any of you remember that they did that? That the government bureaucrats used to do that, okay? That was the premise. We've got to have more women in sports. By golly, that's so important, we're going to kick the boys out of wrestling. Now, how that helps, I don't know, but we redefine dance to be a sport so that can meet the bean counters at Title IX, you know, that we now have as many girls involved as boys in sports. But now, the very same Title IX is being used to say that a person's identity, gender identity, is whatever they say it is. And so we now have boys who claim that they think that they're girls competing in girls' sports and winning state championships. That's this boy here with the dreadlocks. Okay? He won 2 girls' state championships. Now think about that for like 30 seconds. That's the end of girls' sports. That's the end of women in sports. Direct contradiction. All right? The image on the other side is a man who decides he's a woman. He is a boxer. He's a boxer, and he competes against women boxers. And he beat a woman so badly in a cage match that it ended her career. Okay, so in other words, people are watching a man batter a woman, and we're supposed to be okay with this. This is why there are many radical feminists and lesbians who are absolutely adamantly opposed to the whole transgender movement. You heard the previous speaker allude to this. Here's why. The radical feminists do not appreciate men invading women's spaces, right? When they put on a women's music festival or a lesbian film festival, they don't want a bunch of guys in dresses showing up and claiming to be part of the thing, okay? And so this particular person here is called Sheila Jeffries. She's a radical feminist for a lifetime, and she's absolutely opposed to the transgender movement, and I wanted you to have her references there. The trans activists have even come up with a name for them called trans-exclusionary radical feminists. That's their mean name that they use to marginalize them and try to shut them up. They call them TERFs. Okay? So this is how, in a sense, the sexual revolutionaries are devouring their own children, right? But this is where it has come to. This is what it's come to. So here's a related contradictory thing between different parts of the sexual revolution. On the one hand, you all know this, a person who experiences same-sex attraction is born that way and is expected to remain that way, and no therapeutic help or intervention should ever be given to that person. He needs to come to terms with the fact that he is born gay. On the other hand, if you're a boy and you think you're a girl, you were not born that way. You are immediately surrounded by people to assist you in becoming the new person you want to be, namely a girl. Okay, and the previous speaker spoke a lot about the dangers associated with that and the lack of scientific support for that. So these are some more references. These are the references to the people who are critical of this view. How do these two versions of the ideology fit together? I puzzled over this for a long time. How does this work? It seems crazy. You know, you're all shaking your heads. It seems crazy. How are they making this work together? In both cases, the human body is unimportant, and it can be transcended either by social engineering and social reconstruction or by physical, personal, individual reconstruction. In both cases, you need a lot of power from the state. You need a lot of physical stuff to go along with it, right? To make it appear that the body is unimportant. And so really what we've got is a new field for the law and politics and technology to overwrite the truth of the human person. It's the human body that these people object to. This is a war against the human body. And when you see it that way, then you know we can't give any quarter to it. It's not about compassion. It's about truth. There's nothing compassionate about folding on a question of that importance. So I have up here a couple of questions that are considered contested questions. Are people really born that way? Can people change their patterns of attractions, behaviors, or commitments? And how do we help our loved ones? Now, I'll go through this fairly quickly because a lot of this material has been covered by other speakers. This is a longish quote, a lot of type on a slide. You're not supposed to put a lot of type on the slide, but there you are. This is a quotation from the American Psychological Association, which I would just point out to you. They admit that they have no idea. Okay, let me read it to you. There is no consensus among scientists about the exact reasons that an individual develops a heterosexual, bisexual, gay, or lesbian orientation. Although much research has examined the possible genetic, hormonal, developmental, social, and cultural influence on sexual orientation, See, I told you I could talk fast. No findings have emerged that permit scientists to conclude that sexual orientation is determined by any particular factor or factors. Many think that nature and nurture both play complex roles. Okay? This is the APA. They admit it. They admit it. They act as if it's not true, but when pinned to the wall, this is what they have to say. And I would add for you, because I worked on the Proposition 8 campaign in California, so I followed it very closely. I was actually a campaign spokeswoman for the initiative. And if you followed it through the courts and you look at all the documents and all the experts that they brought into court to defend the idea that man-woman marriage was biased and bigoted and outdated, the homosexual lobby did not bring forward a single person to testify that people are born that way and that sexual orientation is an immutable trait. There is not one witness in all of those court documents that say that. Everybody acted as if that was true, but nobody stood there and said, I can prove it, and it's true. Okay, now, to me, that says our legal team dropped the ball. They should have been all over that. But we weren't for whatever reason, and so there you are. But I point that out to you, and if anybody finds out otherwise, please let me know, because I'm pretty sure it's not in there. All right. Can people change? Sexual orientation may be quite fluid over the life course for some people. This is the report that the previous speaker referred to, so I have the complete reference for you here, and you can get to it if you want to. Can people change? Now, can people change? Here's a good question. This is a book, this is the cover of a book called Why I Don't Call Myself Gay. And it's written by a friend of mine named Daniel Mattson, who is a same-sex attracted man who is Roman Catholic. And this is the story of his conversion, okay? And it is a very powerful story. It is a very holy story. And I will tell you guys for the record, the people I know who are same-sex attracted, who have left the lifestyle, are some of the holiest people that I know, without any doubt at all, okay? And Dan's definitely one of them, all right? So one of the things Dan will tell you is how you choose to identify yourself absolutely is a decision. That's absolutely a choice. You can have all kinds of feelings. People have all kinds of feelings they can't control. They pop up out of nowhere. But you have a choice about what importance to assign them, what to do with them, what meaning to assign it, and so on. Okay? So, and behavior is certainly a decision. And all of that can change. All right? All of that people can control and can change. So how can we be helpful to people? Again, we've heard quite a bit of this here today, but we need to support, one piece of it that I want to emphasize is that we need to support people sense themselves as male or female, as young man or as a young woman. These other things are all people have talked about. You know, give them some space to talk, including talk about their sexual abuse and their trauma, anything like that. People need some space to talk, and be friends with people. Include them in activities. Okay, if you're going fishing, include that kid who seems like he might be a little bit effeminate or maybe thinks he's gay or something. Take him along, for crying out loud, you know? Nothing bad's going to happen on a fishing trip, you know? Just be sure that you are including people and being friends with them. But also, I think in this day and time, because of the whole transgender movement, it's very important that we support each other in our sense of maleness and femaleness. And boys need to hear that there are a lot of ways to be a boy. It's okay to be a boy who likes pink, okay? It just is not that stinking important, right? It's just not that important. There are a lot of ways to be a boy. Just because you like music and you don't like football, you are still a boy. I want to say one other thing about Dan Mattson and his book here. Out there at our table, I don't have Dan's book, but I do have a film, a DVD called Desire of the Everlasting Hills. And this is something that was produced by Courage, which is the Roman Catholic apostolate for same-sex attracted men and women. And this DVD called Desire of the Everlasting Hills is the testimony of three people and walks through their, you know, what their life was like when they were practicing the lifestyle, how they got out of it, what their life is like now, and so on. We're giving that away for purchases of $50 or more of stuff off of our table. So I have a bunch of those, and I want to give them to you. And so that's what we're going to do. All right. Now, here's another guy. This is also another Catholic guy. I'm the token papist here today, so I got the Catholic out, you know, the Catholic references. But anyway, Joseph Sciambra was a former gay porn star. And his material is very powerful, very raw. I do not recommend you let your teenage kids go look at it, but I think you need to go look at it because you need to know what this is actually like. He does not hold anything back. He talks about all kinds of medical problems that he ended up with from his activity, from even a very short amount of activity. You can end up with some very serious medical problems that nobody talks about. So it's quite raw, and like I said, I don't necessarily recommend it for young people, but you adults, you need to go look at it, okay? You need to know what this guy went through. All right. Oh, now, also, I want to just call attention to the fact that the Ruth Institute has a couple of reports on these topics. We produced a report on the Department of Justice transgender guidelines. Do you remember in the waning days of the Obama administration, the Department of Justice sent out guidelines to every public school in America, basically threatening them with loss of funding if they did not open all their bathrooms and obey all the rules and so on and so forth. We have a report on that, and so I put that here. Also, I have the a couple of other reports here, and this material will be helpful to you if you want to go and battle with your school board. This is what this material was designed to do, was to give you the information you need to deal with that. Let me say just a word about intersex people, okay? So intersex people, sometimes you will hear people say there is no gender binary because there are intersex people. And I want to just deconstruct that a little bit, all right? I want to just break that down a little bit for you. There are about 15 different intersex conditions, and that means somebody either has a chromosomal issue or a physical abnormality, some kind of developmental issue where they're not obviously either male or female. Something unusual has happened with their development. Here are the things I want to say about that. There are a wide variety of these conditions, and they are medical diagnosable conditions. They can be diagnosed by a doctor. Some of these conditions are not obvious at birth. They only become obvious later. They're not immediately visible. Some are actually life-threatening. A few of them are. And some of these conditions need to be monitored and watched for possible development of other complications that could come along with it. The reason for saying all these things is that a child who is genuinely intersexed needs parental supervision. They do not need to change their sex at school and never tell anybody, okay? That makes no sense at all for the people who have these medically diagnosable conditions. So that's your clue that there's something that when the transgender activists pull out the intersex people and say, look here, you see there is no gender binary, that's a sleight of hand. That's a sleight of hand. You need to recognize that as a sleight of hand because the minute they're done, they pull back. They pull back from talking about these people, and I've got references for that. Let's talk briefly about gender dysphoria or gender disorder, okay? Gender identity disorder. Gender dysphoria in children describes a psychological condition in which they experience a marked incongruence between their experienced gender and the gender associated with their biological sex. It is a psychological condition. The intersexed condition and transgenderism are different because transgenderism, per Department of Justice guidelines, no diagnosis is required. The Department of Justice was quite explicit that if a child shows up and says, I'm a boy and I want to use the boy's restroom, that little girl does not need a diagnosis in order to do that. Okay? So the difference is it's self-diagnosed, not medically diagnosed, and parental involvement is actually prohibited under those guidelines. So in general, here's what we can say. Intersex is a medical category. Gender dysphoria is a psychological category. And transgender is a political category invented for political purposes. It has nothing to do with either psychology or medicine. It is a political category. So you need to see that so you stop feeling sorry for these people. Because feeling sorry for the person with a genuine problem is not what it's really all about. If they were really worried about those people, they'd want their parents involved, right? They'd want their parents involved. And it goes back to the overall picture of what is this really all about? It's about deconstructing gender itself. It's about saying there's no real such thing as male and female. What is the end game of this movement? The end game is the complete removal of male and female from society and the law. That's where they're headed. And you need to see that, okay? All right, so who benefits from the transgender ideology? Well, above all, the government. The government is amassing enormous amounts of power under this label, all right? Because young people redefine their identities with or without parental supervision, and the government actively inserts themselves between the child and the parents in some cases, actively separating children from their parents. The government is empowering itself with these rules. And people can redefine their gender identities in New York State. You can be fined up to $250,000 for misgendering somebody. A school teacher is about to lose his job for misgendering a student. Okay, so this is a power grab, plain and simple. You need to see that. Now, let me mention a couple of downsides to the transgender ideology. Again, something for everybody to be aware of. There are a couple of very serious issues that you never hear talked about, and that is the possibility that you have misdiagnosed somebody. That somebody thinks they want to be a girl, or they think they want to be a boy, and really there's something else going on. Now, this particular case is a case that I wrote about. This person here is a person named Nancy, who was born Nancy Verhelst. She was Belgian, and she wanted to be a man, and so she had herself sterilized and a double mastectomy. And when that happened, she did not like the way it turned out. And you can see the headline that the mainstream media gave: Belgian killed by euthanasia after botched sex change operation. This is propaganda, my friends. On every level, it's propaganda. First of all, they're using the guidelines that say, don't ever say Belgian man or Belgian woman when you got a transgender, okay? So that, you see that, it's just a Belgian, a generic, non-gendered Belgian. Secondly, the person was euthanized, that is true, but there was nothing botched about this sex change operation. The only thing botched was that she didn't like the result of it. She didn't like the way she looked. She didn't like the way she felt. And so she asked to be euthanized, and of course in the progressive place of Belgium, she was euthanized. Well, it turns out, when you look a little more deeply into it, you find out that her mother really wanted a boy. Her mother rejected her. Her mother really wanted a boy, and what this poor girl needed was somebody to love her. And somebody should have slapped her mother. So I wrote about this article when this came out. Then there's transgender reversal. Walt Heyer writes very movingly and powerfully about the issue of transgender reversal, and he concludes, this is an important website for everybody to be aware of, Sex Change Regret. He talks about it in terms of masking underlying child abuse. In his case, there was child abuse involved, and there was also a personality disorder, okay? And nobody ever diagnosed that. Everybody was so focused on getting him into a dress or whatever that they never addressed the underlying pathology that really needed to be addressed. And so that's another huge downside of rushing kids into this type of stuff. So the sexual revolution, in short, and I've only talked about the gender ideology part of the sexual revolution. I could go on all day about the other parts of it that are on your little pamphlet that you have there. But the sexual revolution is irrational, and it's impossible. This part of the sexual revolution, the gender ideology, wants to say that there is no difference between men and women. That is untrue. It's completely untrue. Therefore, if you're going to create a fantasy ideology, if you think it's your duty, your moral duty, to create a fantasy world in which men and women are exactly the same, you can't do it. But the fact that it's impossible does not stop anybody. The fact that it's impossible actually just means that it takes a lot of force and it takes a lot of propaganda. And that's what I want to speak with you about now, is more of the propaganda and just really help you pin down what's going on here. The sexual revolution is a totalitarian ideology that no Christian should have anything to do with. We've been playing pussyfoot with this thing for way too long, okay? And I don't care whether you're talking about the divorce ideology, the contraceptive ideology, or the gender ideology. We've been tiptoeing around it way too much. They're all irrational, You cannot build a society where men and women are identical. You cannot build a whole society where sex does not make babies. And you cannot build a whole society in which children do not need their own parents. And that's what we're trying to do, okay? And so it's crazy. We're making ourselves crazy. So let's talk briefly about propaganda and some of the motivations. Now, this book is also out there at the table. It's discounted. It's called The Sexual Revolution and Its Victims. And you see whose picture we have up there? We got Marilyn Monroe. We think she is a great icon, I guess you would say, for our point here, which is you can get pictures of Marilyn Monroe on tote bags and t-shirts and all this, and she's a great symbol of glamour and beauty and excitement, right? But you never see a bottle of empty pills laying beside her. You never see that she had 12 abortions. You never see what a miserable life she actually had. That's all airbrushed out of the picture. Right. So all we have is the plus side of the sexual revolution and none of the downside. That's what all of you who are dealing with same-sex attraction ministries, that's what all of you are dealing with too. You see the glamour of the same-sex attracted man. You see Dan Savage. You see all these, you see Ellen, you know, all these characters and so on. You see Will and Grace. But you never see any downside. But choose whatever you want. It'll all be okay. See, very important to silence the victims. Very important to keep the tamp down on the suffering that people have actually endured. And so what are the motives? Why are people doing this? Well, they want to make money. There's a lot of money involved in transitioning. There's a lot of money involved in broken families, right? There are whole industries that have grown up around separating parents from each other and keeping them separate. If mom and dad get married, stay married, and have their own kids and take care of their own kids, nobody makes any money off of that, especially. You know, I have trouble finding people to sponsor my websites, whereas these other people get all kinds of crazy people to sponsor their websites, right? The divorce attorneys will be all over their websites and all of that kind of thing. And what we have to see is that the people who advocate this stuff have enough money to buy their way out of the problems they cause. And the poor people who have to live with the consequences do not have the money to buy their way out of it. The recent allegations and almost certainly true things brought against Harvey Weinstein, okay? Think about this guy. Think about what he was getting away with for years. And think about the amount of money that he donated to keep abortion legal. Just think about that, okay? These are the people running society, the people who are taking advantage of the weak. All right, so let's talk a little bit about propaganda for the sexual revolution. Now, we have a program called Healing Family Breakdown. And at every one of these workshops, I've given an example of propaganda for the sexual revolution. And I always wait until the week before to pick it out because there's always something new in the news. You can always find new stuff. It's everywhere, you guys. It's everywhere. As soon as you start thinking about it, you're going to see it's everywhere. This one was out in August. And the headline was, Why Women Had Better Sex Under Socialism. I can't make this stuff up, okay? This is in the New York Times. And look at this picture. This is double propaganda. Double propaganda, because you know where they got this? The New York Times got this photo out of their archives from the 30s. This photo was undoubtedly propaganda that the Soviets used to prove that there was no problem with collective farming. Look at this healthy, chubby, fat-faced girl, okay? And how happy she is, and when millions of people were starving in the Ukraine, okay? So it's layer upon layer of propaganda. Teen Vogue had an article called Anal Sex, What You Need to Know. Okay, I don't have an illustration up there. There were illustrations with that article. Okay, some of you may have seen it or heard about it. Teen Vogue is marketed to middle school girls. There is nothing that a middle school girl needs to know about anal sex. This was simply priming the kids, priming the girls to be receptive anal sex partners. That's what this is about. I hope the Baptists don't throw me out of here for talking like this on their campus. But anyway, this is what we got to deal with, okay? This is what's out there. All right, propaganda for the sexual revolution. This is a worksheet given out to students, middle school students in Oklahoma, not crazy California, but Oklahoma. What is sex? There are four types of sex: mutual masturbation, oral sex, vaginal sex, blah, 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 blah. Okay, you can look at that when I send it out to you. But middle school students are asked to fill out this worksheet in a public school. And here's the one that really grabs me, Propaganda for the Sexual Revolution. The Human Rights Campaign have a book, well, there is a book out called I Am Jazz, which is about a boy who thinks he's a girl and he has the gender-neutral name of Jazz. He's written a book. He's a hero. He's a star. And they are sponsoring community readings of the I Am Jazz book on December 7th. And this is what they're promoting, okay? Guys, we're surrounded by this stuff. We're surrounded by propaganda for the sexual revolution, okay? And you can see why. It's because it's irrational and cannot stand on its own. It has to be propped up. The sexual revolution has to be propped up. If your position is like our position is, man, woman, come together, have a baby, baby grows up, they take care of the baby, that will stand on its own. You will get confirmation of that theory on a daily basis, right? But if you're saying two men can have a child just like a man and a woman can, you know, you need to work on that to get people to believe that, all right? So, hasn't this gone on long enough? Isn't it time somebody did something about it? Yeah, we think it is too. We think it's time to do something about it. So, did you learn anything today? Yeah, good, good. Is there more that you want to learn? Yeah, I try to leave people wanting more. So, would you like an easy, systematic way to educate yourself and your friends about these issues? All right. Great. The Ruth Institute has developed a concept called book clubs, which you don't even have to buy a book for. And at a book club, you can eat. Wait, yes. Louisiana, the main Cajun vice is gluttony, in case you didn't know. You want to go over there. That's what people are into, eating. But, of course, you read, you can be inspired, you can learn, make friends, live your ideals, and, of course, eat at the Ruth Institute book clubs. Now, and hopefully, change the world. Get together with friends, change the world. Here are a couple of book club topics that we have coming up. This one is called How Jesus Can Heal the Divorce Culture. And what these are is four sessions. You can do them every week, you can do them once a month, however you and your friends want to do it. But it's four sessions. Each session has about 1,200 words worth of reading, so you're not really reading War and Peace. Don't worry, you can manage it, okay? And for example, this particular book club, we have articles by Jennifer Johnson, Pope John Paul II, one by me, and then of course something by Jesus. Remember him? Yeah, he had some things to say about the divorce culture, right? All right, then we have another one coming up. We call the whole thing Fight Loneliness. This is the one about gender identity politics, bathroom bullies and pronoun police, everything you need to know about gender identity politics. Tell me you like this image of this doggy reading the magazine on the toilet. Yeah, we wanted to come up with an image that was kind of non-threatening because everybody's slightly freaked out about these issues, right? I mean, yeah, it's kind of creepy, right? And people don't know what to do, and they don't know what to talk about. So in this one, we have articles by Walt Heyer, whom I've already mentioned, my friend Stella Morabito, and it'll be a lot of fun. Now, so what we're going to do is the Sunday after Thanksgiving, we're having a webinar training session for people who want to lead book clubs, okay? And it'll be a webinar, so it doesn't matter where you are. You dial in, call in, a bunch of us will be on there, and there'll be a session on Sunday and on Tuesday. We're looking for people who are fun-loving, reliable, enthusiastic, and, of course, literate would be good if you're going to lead a book club. So that's what we have to offer. That's what the Ruth Institute is trying to do with all of this. And remember, our objective is to create a mass movement to put a stop to family breakdown. That means everybody's got to be on board. That means we can't leave it to the professionals, whether it's the professional politicians, the professional therapists. Everybody has to have a role. So that's why we came up with something that I think anyone can be able to do if you're so inclined. And so out there we have a number of books. This book, I also want to mention that we have this called, this is a four DVD series called Same-Sex Marriage Affects Everyone. This is something that we created during 2008, during Proposition 8, and it's amazing how much all of that is still true, how it all still holds. And there's a study guide that goes with it at no charge.
Thank you, Dr. Moore.
Very welcome. Very welcome.
You've just been listening to Dr. J speaking on the gender ideology from Mass Resistance's Teens for Truth Conference at Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary in Fort Worth, Texas. I'll link to the Acton Ideology Talks Dr. J mentioned in the podcast notes on our website, and there you can also find out more about our upcoming training webinar and the book clubs Dr. J mentioned. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook. Like the Ruth Institute or Dr. Jennifer Roback Moore's pages for updates. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love and healing within the family.